Hi, okay. Hi, Andrew.
Hello.
Hi. So let's begin. I'll make a very brief introduction. This is a conversation that is part of the public program of the School of Architecture and Urban Studies of Universidad Torquato di Tella. We're really pleased and glad to have Foke with us. She will be having a conversation with Andrew Pringle. Andrew is a professor at the school, and now he'll introduce Foke. So the conversation takes part in a cycle that's been going on for almost 2 years now. That is the Joyful Players cycle that organizes conversations between professors from the school and architects who we believe have positioned themselves as influential players on a planetary scale. And these conversations explore different modalities in which the rules of contemporary architectural thought are radicalized and in ways that they are rethinking and renewing the cultural meaning of their deployment. And combining candor and seriousness, relevance is sought through the playful construction of relevant issues, boldly addressing the role of disciplinary specificity in the contemporary world. Joyful Players explores, in this sense, the ability of architects to define the architectural game board and the modes of doing architecture on a global scale. So, without further ado, I pass it to Andrew.
Okay. Great. So I will first introduce Foke. So welcome, Foke. Thank you for accepting our invitation to be here with us today. Please correct me if I'm wrong about pronouncing your name incorrectly. It's Foke Murell. She has a master's degree in architecture from the Academy of Architecture in Rotterdam and a bachelor's degree in interior architecture from the William de Kooning Academy. She's a partner of MDRDB and was one of the first architects to join in 1998. She also directs Studio Public inside MDRDB, a unit of the office that focuses on projects with urban impact, including public and cultural buildings, as well as transformations of monumental buildings that seek to revive their immediate context. To this end, the office interior design team is also within Studio Public, generating a strong relationship between interior and exterior public program. She leads the project for the Boymans van Beuningen, an art repository fully accessible to the public that will open its doors in 2021, bringing visitors to a close connection with masterpieces and with the city. She has directed award-winning projects such as the Baltic Office Tower in Poland, the Book Mountain Library in Spijkenisse, and the Cultural Embassy in Amsterdam. She has taught at Harvard and Cambridge alongside MDRDB founding partner Natalie De Vries and Silpakorn University in Bangkok, Thailand. She's currently a professor at The Hague Royal Academy of Arts and an external critic at the Academy of Architecture in Rotterdam. Just to finish this introduction, I just wanted to say that we are very interested in your ideas on what you call awe-inspiring and fun architecture, what we are calling joyful or joviality. In relation to radical inclusivity through, let's say, the internalization of the public domain in architecture. We'd like to center the conversation on those themes. And for that, we've put together a grid of projects in which you've been the partner in charge. This grid is mostly for people to get a quick reference of the projects we'll be talking about. So, I mean, we've already mentioned this to you in an email, but for the audience, my plan is to talk about the projects, to ask you questions about them. Looking at them together and grouping them in different ways through common features, traits, or characteristics. So we can, through the conversation, construct different strategies that put forward a general idea of a joyful architecture. So, again, welcome, Foke, and thank you very much for being here with us today.
Well, thank you. It's until now a pleasure. Let's see how it goes the rest of the evening. No, but it's nice to be in this conversation. Sure. Thank you for the invitation.
Okay. okay. So to start with, before I put up the grid, and we can still see our faces, I wanted to ask you about your role in the in the projects as a partner in charge. I mean, because MBRDB is a big firm based in Rotterdam, but working on projects around the world with big design teams, I was thinking that to start with, it'd be great if you could tell us about what your process of design is.
In how much time? that's a pretty big question. How the process is? Yeah, no. I think it's pretty straightforward, actually. But I think you asked more about my role in the project or the process itself. What's the?
No, your role in the context of the process itself. But yeah, mainly your role.
Okay. Yeah, no, at this moment, indeed, we just crossed the boundary of 300 people in our office. So that's not only in Rotterdam, but all the satellites included, which is indeed quite a lot of people for Dutch standards, for sure. And therefore, we divided the office in 8 studios. Besides the satellites, we have one. So the headquarters, let's say, is here in Rotterdam. Doesn't really show, but I'm in Rotterdam. we have a satellite in the oldest one is in Shanghai. Then we have one in Paris. We have one in Berlin since a year now. And also starting up one in New York pretty soon. So, but the main office has, let's say, around 250 people at this moment. And yeah, because of the size, of course, already years ago, we needed to split it up in teams. So we have studios, indeed, as you also mentioned. There's 8 studios, and each led by either a partner or a studio director. That's a bit an overlap. Meaning that I run one of those studios. For instance, most of them are region-based. So we have an Asian studio, one of EMEA, German, French, and urban, but also two, one of the Americas, and two based on the focused on the Netherlands. And mine is focused on public buildings. Also with the region, it's mostly Europe. But so that's how we divide the office in different, let's say, teams, because that's, of course, needed. Otherwise, it's undoable. And each with their own focus. So, yeah, my role in this, first of all, is being part of the management team as a partner. Looking forward, trying to set a strategy for the coming years, understanding what's going on, what is good as an employer and for the employees. And besides that, of course, indeed steering a studio, which means, you know, everything that comes to it, doing acquisition, keeping track of all personnel, planning, staffing. So the administration and the management behind it, of course, with a lot of help and support. And then besides that, luckily, we also have a lot of projects. So that's where the fun part starts, of course. So there's, I have 22 people in my team at this moment. That's the, I would say, the average for each studio. And yeah, so I'm there at the start when we need to select projects, like which one would we like to go for, which competition would we like to enter. So that process, the business development side, let's say, I'm deeply involved. Also trying to get, of course, projects in, doing the tenders and the interviews, etc., or the competitions, as I just said. And then if we and for the other projects or the winning projects, we have teams, and I would be steering that on headlines. And sometimes it depends a bit on the project and what kind of team we have on it. So sometimes I'm a bit on the side, making sure that everything is arranged. But most of the time, I'm really deeply involved in all the content. So internally and externally, going to the site, meeting the client, of course, having the main presentations and meetings, but also, of course, internally, keep track. 20 people is good to overseeable, so that's a nice size of team.
And you mentioned that besides doing all those tasks and working on current projects, you also you call it see where things are going, or trying to identify future trends, or sort of a more prospective or future planning. What does that involve? I mean, is it a research-based practice done within the studio?
Yeah, both. It's on the one hand, of course, very just following the economy. That's like what is going on in the world, which regions are interesting for us, because there's good clients, there's a good culture, let's say, there's interesting projects, but also there's a good economy. So that is one end, and you can see it go back and forth, yeah, or go up and down, I should say. So sometimes a certain region is just more difficult, and then we might focus on another one, or we say, no, we're really interested to really work here, so we put a bit more effort to it. So that is one region-based market, following the markets. But of course, also setting out your own strategy as an office. How do you want to deal with the urgencies in the world? How do you want, what kind of clients would you like to have? What and how can you find them? Where do you see the right projects that you would like to add, you know, you want to contribute to? Where do you see interesting developments going on? So this is, and you can, yeah, so it's a mission, vision, a statement that you, together with all the partners, you develop, and together with the management, you try to make a plan of how to get the best out of it, let's say. And of course, each studio would make their own business plan, focused on, okay, this is what I would like, what kind of project, what do you still have in your wish list? What do you still really, or still, what do you really would want to do as a type of project? And how can we make sure that we get it in within, I don't know, a certain amount of time? So that's different things to, and on looking at different timelines. Yeah? Some are just for the coming year. Other strategic plans are more for coming 5 years, or maybe even for 10 years. So in these different levels, you like, how many satellites do we want to have? Where and which country would you like to go to? How do we organize this? These kind of things, of course, all come across our meetings, let's say.
Okay. No, I have a small quote from you, and if it's okay, before going into the projects, I was thinking that it'd be good to read it out loud.
I hope it's a good one.
I think it can give us a good head start. So it's I think it's a response to a question, which is why I love the spirit of MBRDD, and which to your answer is, I'm strongly attached to the office's mission to not exclude anyone or anything. It brings a wide diversity of challenges, which can lead to unconventional and innovative possibilities, always inspiring and fun. So, I mean, in relation to this quote, I wanted to ask you about inclusivity, or let's say radical inclusivity, because you're saying nothing or anyone is excluded. And in what ways or through what means do you think some of these projects, I will put up the grid projects. Let me do this. So you're seeing the grid, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. So in what ways or through what means do you think some of these projects incorporate something or someone that, let's say, a standard or non-inclusive project could not be capable to do? It's a very broad one, you know? It's,
yeah, exactly. Each project, I think, has a different answer. And of course, that's the nice thing that you per project you really look at, you know, what is the site, what is the what is the request, what is the brief, and yeah, what are all the potentials? So, for instance, looking at the Boekenberg in Spijkenisse, which you pronounced very well, which is the one next to Love. The right one next to Love, the pyramid, yeah,
this
the Book
one,
Mountain.
Yeah.
It's a library, but yeah, as in, and it opened, I think in 2006, even 2000, yeah, somewhere there. So quite some years ago already. But once we started with the competition, there was an article about Spijkenisse, which is a very small municipality, very close to Rotterdam. This municipality had the lowest rate of people who could actually read, and then opening up a library is quite a message. So and it's not just a library, and that is what you see here. And of course the image is just cut off, but it's basically what we have built is the maximum envelope that was possible on this site. And so you have a zoning plan, which restricts you to, like, you can only be within this space. And that was this space. So basically we maximized our volume to what was feasible within the zoning plan, but it was too big, it was too large for the program in the brief. But that was of course intentional to see, okay, how much can we build without going over budget, et cetera? How much can we build? How much of environment can we make so we can actually enhance the reading more? And how can we invite people from this municipality actually to a library, maybe with different means, maybe with in a different way, and still being more of a host, let's say, for the community. So you have this pyramid inside, you see a little bit of the glare.
Here's an inside picture.
Okay, exactly. So on the right hand side, you see the black bookcases, which were actually made from recycled plastic, and they sort of spiral up onto sort of like a pyramid. And then on top, you have a bit of a square with mm-hmm. trees, and around you can see it's space, of course, for the library, but it's also inside and outside. There's space much more than being a library. There's people just coming in the morning reading. There's a lot of students coming around, of course, which you see normally in libraries, but this was very specific for this municipality since, yeah, as I just said, it was not very lively up till then. So it's creating the air, as you can see, between the bookcases and the roof is creating and using that air basically make a roof, one big roof for this community. And they really, from day one, started to make use of it. So that's the inclusivity, not just to look at the program or the brief itself, but really trying to find the in-between, very literally here, the in-between space that people can inhabit without any reason, basically, just to and engage and find each other. So that's one one way. Maybe another way is not the Baltic in Poland. It's the black building, like in the left row in the middle. Yeah, that one. And also this image, you can see it is a very, let's say, commercial tower. It's not a public building, but there was some space in between these two buildings. So you see a little square on the right hand side, which was just behind the Baltic building. It's on the ring of the of Poznan, a Polish city. So you had to. So this was just on the edge of where people would actually walk or go, let's say, in the weekend. So it would be very empty after hours, let's say, after working hours. And by positioning the building right here and by integrating the square as a design, it now actually is used and curated also with cinema, with workshops, with bands, music, you know, little festivals, to also create another vibe, to try and get people there, and it works also after hours or during lunchtime or in the morning. Or so it's another way of trying to be, so you add something and you give something back. That is sort of the principle. You want me to point out another one?
I was thinking that in relation to what you're mentioning about that in-between space, literally that creating voids or spaces to occupy. I don't know what you think, but maybe also, I don't know, for example, this one, the Osoko, this one more obviously than Ragnarok, but through big structural efforts, you're able to produce semi-interior spaces, even though they are out in the open. And these are, where at least Wasoko, it's not a public building, you know. So that's also an interesting way of at least linking these projects.
Well, indeed, too. So Roskilde or Rock Magnet, so the golden one right in the left corner, is indeed, as you say, a structural effort to create this in between space. That was the idea here, to make a canopy, to have outdoor space, and also having bands outside as a podium, as a stage, really marking the entrance to this rock museum. Yeah, with the red carpet going right inside through this rather industrial area. So it's creating something beautiful in an area which is a bit rough, let's say. So that's one way of creating an in-between space. But the Wozoko actually does a bit of the same, but at the same time, it has a totally different background, which is quite funny, because indeed this, you see it hoover, this enormous, you know, volume hoovering above the sidewalk. And we don't have air rights in the Netherlands, as you can see here. This is a clear example of that, or proof. The thing is that the program for this building was too big for the plot. So we needed to come up with some sort of trick to make it happen. So therefore we said, okay, if it doesn't, because there were the zoning restrictions, so we couldn't really build higher than what we did. We couldn't really build deeper because of the depth of the apartments. So then we said, okay, then we hang them. The rest of the program, we just have to hang it from the building. So that's what we did, basically. And that's indeed also creating sort of an in-between space, but it was here, it had a different background.
So it's mostly the opposite of the mountain of books, because, I mean, on the mountain, you have too little program, big site, and this one is too much program, small site.
No, that's also how we like to work. It's we read the brief carefully. We try to understand, of course, the client carefully, not just at the start, but throughout the whole process. It's always a dialogue to find out where these margins are, not just to have, okay, this is the what they need. This is the budget they have, this is the planning they have, but this is what they need. And then to try and see, okay, what can we read in between the lines? That is basically what we would try to do. Is there anything that we would like to add that we think is good for this location or for this building or for this client? Is there anything that they miss out? And we see the opportunity at that moment to actually add without really complicating things. And that is indeed what you see at the Rozoka. That's also what you see at the depot, for instance. Yeah, the stair, the sort of Piranesi image. Yeah, right, that one. It's going to open actually beginning of November. The art depot here in Rotterdam. It's this mirror thing that you saw on the first page. And here you can also see we try to seek here. The big challenge was to together with the client, being the museum and the municipality, trying to find a way of how to make it public, because it's cultural heritage. It's super valuable. It's a lot of artifacts. It's a treasure. So it's a safe, and it's a fridge at the same time, because it needs high-tech conditioning. But how to make it open for public, so they can actually see what they have, because everybody's paying for it via their tax, so it's all ours, but you can never see it. So that was the challenge here because it was not written in the brief, because this is the first building ever to be made in such a way that you can make an art depot indeed publicly accessible. So how do you do this? So it was a whole adventure going through all the phases to find out what it means and what it needs and what kind of design that actually would bring. So that's what you look at right here, but that's one part of it. So from starting with the competition, it was mentioned somewhere like maybe it can be open to public for like 20%. Throughout the phases, at some point we said, okay, no, it should just be fully open, except for the security room. It should be, everything should be accessible. And of course, not in the same way. For some parts, you can actually go up for free, claiming the part of the open space that was there before, just reclaiming it, going up to the roof and having this quite an amazing view over the city. 360 degrees, so that would be for free, or going up to have dinner, or to buy a ticket and go through all the galleries, or to how do you say it, or to ask for special permission to see a certain piece of art, which is really secluded. So there's all different levels, but indeed we try to to visualize, let's say, how to make this treasure part of the city. That is to give it back. And so you claim a little bit of land, which happened to be a park. So that's super vulnerable, of course. It's taking away open air in a dense city. Well, Rotterdam is not that dense yet, so we can still go ahead a little bit. But giving something back that you took away from people who actually live there.
I was thinking maybe going back to the Wasoko project. One of the things that struck me when I first saw that project a long time ago was to see that it was a project for elderly residents. Because, I mean, that's really, I don't know, interestingly shocking, because it's a very jovial, or I don't know, joyful building. Something that you wouldn't associate with elderly. And I think that partly to do with the operation of the cantilevers, it's producing, I don't know, common spaces underneath it, building up a lot of character, joyful character in the building. But in a joyful way, and it has this sort of rationale behind it. But in its effects, I was wondering what effects, if you know, does it have on the residents to live in such a building?
Well, it's basically a slab of apartments. That is very rational. The budget was really not high. So it needed to be very rational. But then indeed again, being able to make more program than actually would fit on the plot, of course, would pay itself back. So it's, and it was part of the program, part of the budget. So they needed to have this. But this was the only, for us at least, this was the only solution to hang them from the main facade. And at first, there were some people indeed hesitating, like, oh, I'm not going to live in this. It's probably going to go like this. And what do you, but you can imagine there's huge diagonals going through this apartment in the wall, of course, on the sides. And and we have some really amazing, cute images with all their family pictures going just like with the diagonal through through their house. So I think they got used to it pretty soon. This is an old building, of course, already for us. And yet, the other part which makes it joyful, I think, is you see some of the balconies here also in these very specific colors. On the other side of the building, there's one basically flat facade of all the ends of the apartments with these colorful balconies. Also, very simple way. With low budget to make it really joyful and to make it very colorful, because these people would like to sit outside as much as possible. And well, you probably know, but in the Netherlands, that's not always the right weather for it. But to just bring some joy in their life on the spot where they would like to sit most. And it's an easy way, as I say, it's an easy way to have a lot of impact, but also that which really impacts their life. It's you know that it had some color. Like now, if you would live in this kind of gray box, you get super grumpy after spending here too much time. But if there's a bit of color in your space and good light, then that already makes a huge difference. If you have to spend more time at home, or if you spend more time at home, so it's simple means. I think that's also what makes it beautiful. I think
simple means, but very strong in its effect. I mean, it's
yeah.
Part, I think that's part of its beauty, that it's exactly. Rationally undeniable, but also it produces a lot of surplus.
No, exactly.
And the one next to it, the Transit Lager, I think it's pronounced, Reloaded?
Yeah, Reloaded, yeah. Transit Lager. It was a competition, really quite some years ago.
2011, I think.
Sorry?
2011.
11, okay, yeah. Yeah, pity we didn't win it. So it stayed a picture. But it was it's a bit like the it's a transformation, and personally I'm very interested in transformations, because that's the first thing if you think about sustainability that would be keeping what is there and reusing it, not just for the reuse of the material and the construction, but also because of the plot and also how it's embedded already in its surroundings. So it has a certain connection, reference, of course, to the surroundings. And there's quite a lot of these on this page. Also the magazine 113, as you see it, it's the, I don't have a cursor, of course, but it's the, on the right, yeah, that one. It's a bit similar to the Transitlager. Unfortunately, also not built. We were quite far. It was actually ready to be built, but in the end, some things came along. But so you see the yellow part at the bottom of the magazine, and that's the old building. That's the existing part. And they're both warehouses in a harbor area, which now, of course, is claimed by the city again. So and the Transitlager was going to be a residential building, and magazine was going to be a co-working space. So to be rented out, but also it was a project done by or initiated by the city itself of Gothenburg, and hosting cultural program like a Kunsthalle, and also some public space going through having a terrace at the top. So that also here, and so Transitlager, of course, is more, let's say, commercial, more private. And so there we really made use of the oversized construction, as you very often see, of course, in these warehouses, by extending these balconies as far as we could, and to give people different views on the site and as big of a balcony as possible. While in the in magazine, we added a whole similar volume right on top of the, that's that one indeed. So the lower part is the existing, and what is on top is new. So it's doubling the volume, doubling the square meters with a new volume because of the oversized construction, which of course is amazing that you can do this. And always adding, like you see here, the red is sort of this public route going through the building, even if it's a co-working and therefore rental space, trying to add a bit of liveliness, also commercial, but then in terms of retail or restaurants, etc. But always combining different programs together. So it's not just a monolith in that sense. It becomes part of the city and an extension of the city. And in this building magazine, it was pretty doable, was very doable in a Transitlager, of course, with different type of program. It's more focused on the residents, but then still have a communal roof as semi-public space. You also have some other. Sorry.
No. Go for it.
Yeah, I was just looking at there's more transformations on this image. Actually, the rock magnet is part of it. That's Concordia, indeed, also a Polish project delivered a year ago in in Łódź, Wrocław, sorry. And that one. It's also partly so where your cursor is at this moment is an existing part of the building, which you so that used to be there, and the rest of it is actually an extension, a new part. But it used to be there, the volume used to be there, and then it got demolished or bombed at some point, and then it was just a singular building on this empty island for so long that nobody actually remembered. That this island, it's sitting on an island in the city river. Nobody really remembered that it used to be completely built full with residential blocks. So we just extended the leftover building, let's say, with the rest that used to be there. And this is also a co-working space. And also here so it's commercial in that sense, but you can see everything that is lit up. Well, not everything, but most of it, especially the roof and the ground level, are public spaces. So you have, well, in that sense, you have a gallery on one end, you have a restaurant on the other end, and you have a panorama platform on the rooftop. And that is actually something that we added along the way. It was not there, it was not part of the brief, but we extended, we also did a bit of an adventure, let's say, together with the client, but also with the city, because a lot of people were actually complaining about this extension of the building, because it was parked before. It's a bit like the depot. There was a lot of people against having something built on this plot. And in the depot, we pulled up the park which was there and put it on top of the roof and made it accessible via an express lift elevator. And in Concordia, we pretty much did the same thing. So we opened up the roof for people to actually go and visit and have a view on the city. So but it was not part of the brief initially. So it's something that we sort of found along the way. We thought that would be really good, and indeed also a lot of people were really happy with it, to see that the building actually becomes part, it's not just introverted, but it becomes part of the surroundings and becomes a backdrop of the new backdrop of their scenery, which they know very well, and again giving something back to the people who used to use this area for a long time.
And does the Concordia rooftop has does the how its height does it has something to do with the maximum envelope, for example, as the mountain?
No. This was just an extension of the. So if you see on the right, it's a bit small, but you see a very classical building, straight facades, and a bit of an inclined roof. And then the rest of the roof is flat. And that is actually the extension, the extrusion, let's say, that we made to the end. So we followed the same silhouette as was already there. And then, but the first part on top of the existing building is, I should say differently. That part has a facade, but the whole rooftop is actually open. So what you look at is more of an open steel frame, which at some points is covered, but it's basically an outdoor space. So it's and in the middle it has this core coming up with some amenities as well, and a green a wall around it to make the ambience. But it's basically like a greenhouse, but even without the glass, not all the glass is there. But it's very comfortable. It has a side screen, so it's out of the wind, and they have a lot of parties and festivals, and but you can just go up there and have a view on the city, which is very central, so it's a good view.
And I was thinking that. No, it's interesting what you're talking about, doing projects on already existing buildings, refurbish them. And I noticed that in many of them, the way you operate is by, let's say, cutting forms into it, you know? As for example, in this one, which is the cultural cluster, I think in Sandstadt, if it's called, or here in the Cube House, maybe it has a relation to what we were talking about previously on the cantilevers, but what I'm getting is that. There's always like a hard and undisputable rationale behind it, but in its effects, it is very it is difficult to relate the effects to that rationale, which is what I was saying, that it's that surplus, and I was wondering. How do you manage that? So, for example, here the cuts are done in such a way that you can still read the old building, but the cat sort of produces an image of also almost immaterializing it, or it reduces its gravitas, let's say. I don't know, these cantilevers are apparently erratic. They're deliberately organized in a way that they don't produce an image of order, let's say. So, yeah, I don't know, maybe if you could talk a little bit about that.
Okay, you touch upon quite a lot of topics at the same time, but it's, I think the overall effect that we try to get is, and like indeed in these projects, you can see everywhere where there's like, well, you have to focus, of course, in projects. There's always a budget, and that's good.
Yeah.
It's a good thing. It's not just something to blame. Because it makes you focus. So if you have a concept for treatment or a design for a new building, then to make that really clear and sharp and readable, like how to not to describe but to invite people and how to use it in different ways, or to invite them in. I think that it really needs a focus. So it needs to be understandable for somebody, how, you know, or inviting for people like to use the building in a way that they they find suitable. And so indeed this cut over the Concordia building, and to have different light there, of course, is because that's the place to be. That's where the people are going. That's the open or the semi-public space. The same thing for Zaandam, the cultural center, the gray box with the colorful cutouts. This is a fully new building, actually, but also this didn't get built, really. It was almost signed by a contractor, and then in the end, politicians decided differently. Super, well, disappointing. But what happened here is that many different, so the brief again was super complicated, very complete, it was packed with all these different institutions that would be coming from different parts of the city into this one center. And so first of all, you need to solve this puzzle. You have, again, a certain plot that you can use, a certain height, a certain budget, etc. And so that's always too tight, of course. So that's the starting point. So first you need to solve this puzzle and make sure that all these different institutions, like a library, a concert hall, a ballet school, a cafe, it's a radio station, etc. So they all needed to be there and and live happily ever after. And that was quite a puzzle in itself. And so all these conditions, so that's the rational thinking to try and solve that. On the other hand, you want to give each of them their own identity. You still want to be able to say, but that is my spot. That's why this is the library which I'm passionate about, or this is the concert hall I always go to, or so you want to be able to make it one holistic entity for the city, to be a sort of a beacon, a cultural beacon in the city, but also for each individual person or visitor to be that they recognize, oh no, but I'm at the right spot, this is where I should be. So that's what we created with these halls and with the different colors, to give this identity in very simple means, with sort of icons that are very, you could see a bit of the facade, which is very typical for the city of Zaandam, and with these sort of shaped tops of the building. So that's so we gave them these kind of, and this is indeed the lobby So you have the cinema on one side, you have the library on the other side, you have the concert hall downstairs, and then some bridges in between. So still, it's one place. It's everybody feels comfortable. So that's coming back to the inclusivity again. Like, it's not just one mainstream. No, it's trying to bind all the different people from all the different visitors, trying to find their own good old cinema, which they loved, let's say, in the other end of the city. So that's the same for Cuba, which is the image right underneath, the white building with the glass patches. Also here, it's a cultural center built. You can see this is not a render in Copenhagen. And also here was a combination of different program, different functions, different institutions, a bit similar to Zaandam. And where people needed to, or just different parties needed to be taking care of the building, because that's of course also very crucial that they, the people who come there every day, not just as a visitor, but also as an owner, let's say, that they actually take care of the building, that they feel comfortable and they and there's enough, let's say, space physically to not just do the things they normally do, but maybe also invent some new stuff and find each other in that sense. That's of course the crossover of these different institutions is super interesting to see, and it creates a different environment, I would say. So that's also what you see in the facade of Cuba in a much more modest, more Danish maybe way. But then on the inside, if you go to the other page, you can see, I think you had an image of that as well. Yeah, that so here it's the volumes that actually make the puzzle. It's sort of a cubes stacked on top of each other, and they each have their own program and they coincide, of course. And that's where you get the bridges and the interaction, basically. And again, around it, a lot of air to actually be able to see and to intervene and to meet people that hopefully normally you would not meet. So that's adding again air and program or possibilities, basically.
Also, another interesting effect of how you use color, I think, is that because everything is covered with the same color, it's, you can see it very well in the Liden village, which is the floor is fused with the walls and the roofs, and on the one hand it creates an image, a very simple image. It doesn't have it, you cannot read parts or how they are assembled together. It sort of flattens things out, but on the other hand, it also produces the possibility of activating in some way all those surfaces together. Like, this is for example, this image, you know, the woman walking on top of the roof, which is of the same color as the ground, and also in this interior space of the cultural center, which is it takes the idea of gravity, you know, roof and floor are not two coordinate systems. You can sort of go around in multiple directions. And I think color has a big role in it.
That's funny that you indeed point out the Didden village, the blue houses right in the middle with the lady on top. I think you're right. It's again inviting people to use the piece of architecture or objects in a way that you that we did not think of, but it's inviting, and I think that's the whole clue. Of course, you want to give the people what they need. There's a client and there's their request, but always give something like a bonus, or at least a platform. And by using one color, indeed, it makes it abstract. Of course, it sort of makes it all look very simple, which very often it's not. But it makes it abstract to also. So it's easy to actually add new layers on top, which are maybe temporary, just like different uses. And you see a bit of the same. Why this? You don't see it in the image. Also, not the other one, I think. But this is you see a bit in the back, the historic. If you go back to the other slide, now you see in the background. You see the historic houses, right? So that's
here.
Exactly. That is what the neighborhood is about. So it's all sort of 1900 residential area, this was a family of four, and they had a beautiful house, but it was also their works atelier, and they needed more space. And other than this one, because you look at a house with a pitch roof, but they had a flat roof. So they thought, okay, we really don't want to move out of the city. We want to stay here. And that's, let's say, the more traditional way to go. If you're expanding your family or whatever, you want to move out of the city and then have a garden, et cetera. But they were like, we don't want to leave. So, which of course is a good thing, because there's hardly any life in city centers. It's only business these days. So they had a flat roof. So he said, okay, well, let's put something on the roof and let's maybe create a new little paradise, a little village just for you. And and then how do you deal with this? Because it was protected area, not a monument they're building, but the area itself was protected. So how do you deal with this heritage? And then we said, okay, then we need to make a contrast. It needs to be very different, and therefore the colorful addition. So it's very clear that you have this beautiful historic area on the ground level with 3-4 stories, and then on top of that you create a new horizon. Basically, you have a new view. It's like she could not go high enough to have the view. And also create a new world by really making a different addition on top. And that's also what you see in the Schiedam, it's the museum in Schiedam, which is, if you go diagonally, it's a bit like chess, eh? Now it's going, that one. Yeah, you were just on it with the red. Yeah, that one. If you go to the first slide, maybe you can see it. That one. This is also indeed adding, but here's the piece of furniture basically, adding something new to a historic, and this was a monument, to a historic place. This was a museum, is still a museum of modern art in a city quite close to Rotterdam. And this is a chapel, which is right in between, because there used to be a cloister with a chapel right in the middle. And but the chapel they didn't use because they thought it was too fragile, it's very uncommon to actually start to use it in, let's say, a commercial way. So but then at some point they're like, well, this is really a waste of space. So let's start and inhabit. But how to do this? Because here actually the brief was again way too big for the space that we could do, and we could not even touch anything inside. We couldn't put a nail into the wall, basically. So anything we did was just putting it. We just brought in a piece of furniture, and it's actually four sides. It's not now you see one side, but it's all four sides are this cabinet like, incorporating everything they needed, like a cafe, indeed. So in the first two images above, you can see we tried like a pyramid. We tried different volumes. And then we think, this is just sort of blocking the space. That's not, that's counter being counterproductive. So as we said, okay, let's use the walls, bring in pieces of furniture, and then one is a restaurant, the other one is the cafe, and yet another one is the store, and the other one is a ticket booth. So it's a bit like that. And leaving the rest of the space intact, giving it one color, again, just to be super clear. Yeah. This is we're not intervening with the history here. We just add, and if it's redundant, you can take it out. So that's a bit the way of approach for these historic buildings.
No, I was thinking that a little bit through the conversation, sort of that there are like, I don't know, obviously there are a lot of strategies, but very broadly, a group of them have to do with structure. I mean, about making big structural efforts. I mean that in a good way. And what that does is produce those in between spaces, and also because of the big effort, it makes a sort of monumentality. It gives a building a monumental character without being serious. And even if it's not a public building, it gives or imbues that building with that monumental character. And what's interesting about that is that because of that, it's also public. I associate monuments with public buildings. So even in the cases of private buildings, they are imbued with that. And on the other extreme, I mean, let's say that the structure has to do with the innermost parts of the building or its bones. But on the other extreme, you have the ways you operate with color, which are on the, I don't know, outermost layer of the building, its surface, and that in its own way also produces effects of what we were talking about, no? About producing multiple identities within a one cohesive building, flattening different aspects of elements that create new possibilities of inhabiting them. I think that maybe one last thing I was wondering about is this—I don't know how to call it—but calligraphic or typographic buildings that use words, like they're explicitly using words.
Maybe one before we step into another. But I think you call them monuments. I like the way you describe it. I would like to. Because with a monument, normally people would start to think like, okay, this is something we cannot touch, it has a status and it cannot change. I think that is the part of a monument which I would like. So maybe it's more that these buildings, I would like to see them as having character, but also to be indeed to give identity to its surroundings. I think that is important, and not just as a statement, but just more that it can actually interact, and by that, so everybody can relate to this type of building as it already has a certain character. I think that is this interaction and flexibility in use and in program changes, maybe even. That would be if that type of monument I would like, but just as a static, I think that's that would be a pity, because indeed it was a nice remark. But it should be usable. Yeah, but letters, that's a different chapter. Yeah, maybe the one right in the middle, that's the Berghalle, Berg 12. It's a German unit. And it's basically, again, being super rational and just creating as much tenant space as possible. And so to make completely emptied out floor plates, because we put all the logistics, let's say, on the side. So on the outer side of the facade, so the elevator, the stairs, the corridor. So that's all on the outside. And then inside, it's just rentable space. And it was flexible. Each floor could be something else. It could even be divided in two tenants per floor or four tenants per floor. So that's still open, but still using the same corridor or gallery, I should say, on the outer, on the perimeter of the building, and indeed the same stair. So you would still have these people meeting each other on these spaces at the same time. And the letters, Kim, we had so many different options for what to put on the facade. And so at some point we said, okay, we should just, because we really wanted this building to speak literally to its surroundings. It's again in a old industrial area in Munich, which is completely now taken over by indeed retail workspaces. It's super lively. It's a very nice neighborhood, and but this is one of the new buildings. There's a lot of transformations around this this one, and so at some point we just made it a competition. So poets or writers or whoever wanted to subscribe to entered the competition, and this is sort of fun, actually. It's just simple, and it speaks to everybody, and in every language, everybody understands or has their own connotation to it. So it's it always works, and it always brings a smile on your face. So that's something we wanted to achieve. Yeah, so they even did it in the inside. This is actually rented out. Space became a gym with a pool, and they did the same. But then, of course, water. Pretty simple. But it's it's nice to see that something that you project like onto a design or onto execution, is that it's also picked up by others, either by the client or in this case by the tenant, that it starts to have its own life, and that's of course the whole that's the whole goal, I would say that it
what it reminded me of is that you know, those type of programmatic diagrams. OMA did a lot of them in the 90s. Which is like a section with areas colored and big text that describe the program inside of them, but that name the program. On the exterior, it's not the case, but maybe I was in this pool area, the fact that the letters say water to sort of encapsulate all that is going on inside that space, I was thinking that it's also another way of reducing things to a very simple message, as color functions in other ways about flattening things. But in this case, also it does that. I mean, you see a picture and you see water in the pool, but then again, you read water in the letters, and that sort of repetition, it's very humorous. With a repetition, it adds a joyful quality to the water that it wouldn't exist if those letters were not on it. And it brought me back to those diagrams of programs because those diagrams also all had a lot of, I don't know, joy in it. And but here it is translated into a building, which I thought was very interesting.
No, but I think indeed simplifying, it's not to simplify life. As such, it's so complicated. You'd like to sometimes just see simple messages and then be able to add to that. I think that is the indeed to make it also life a little bit easy and reflect how do you say that? I don't know the English word at this moment, but to be able to simplify life at certain moments, I think is actually a good point. And indeed, to copy something like this is a very literal one. To add color is another one. To just make simple messages is another one. And it always creates a platform. I think that is the. It always invites people to actually use it in the way it's meant or in another way. That is basically, we create platforms. I think that is indeed coming back to the inclusivity. That is what I at least, where I find most of the joy to see and to see how people interact with our designs, like how, you know, yeah, things you did not imagine. Like, for instance, with the book mountain we talked about before, the first thing that happened there is like a gay couple married on the stairs because they liked it. They were immediately embracing the building. Well, I mean, that's such a compliment. It's that's super nice. These kind of things very make it valuable, let's say, for what you're doing.
Okay. No, I think that's a great remark to maybe call Manuel if he's around. Maybe we can have a few questions.
Okay, here I am. Okay, yeah, maybe we might have one or two questions of the audience, or maybe shyness will win. I don't know, but the conversation was amazing, I think, and very, very, very stimulating. And well, if we have time, I had a question of my own. I think throughout the conversation, something like an ethics of surplus space was going around, and a surplus space that allows for encounters, novelty, or parties, or happiness, or enjoyment, or different types of engagement. And I was wondering, how do you trace the lineage of these ethics? If maybe the source of this is the history of architecture, or the contemporary world, or the recent history of architecture, or where?
What do you mean, where we would place ourselves in that sense?
No, I mean, I think there is an ethics of surplus space, and I was wondering where does it come from, or how do you think about or where do you get these ideas for different types of surplus space? Is it in the history of architecture, or I don't know.
No, it's just our office doesn't really have we tend to look forward and not so much back. So of course there's great examples, and it's mainly is in again also within cities, in the in-between spaces. So it's not so much a specific line in history or a specific architecture genre, or looking at the city itself and trying to see where you find these why would certain places provide such how do you get these conditions that it actually works? And I think that is just, I think that is also the nice thing, that you have really have to again invent every time again without looking back or looking forward or looking at what you did already. It just to see what does this plot or this brief, what this context, what does it have to offer? Where can I find opportunities? So I'm not too sure if it's, and there's a lot of lines, I guess, in history where this, where you can trace back to, but it's not a specific one. So I'm not too sure how to answer this, I have to say.
No, I understand. I mentioned history of architecture, but it could be any other thing. I think you were talking about the contemporary city and
not just the contemporary city. There's also a lot of medieval or cloisters there's a lot of these typologies where it's really indeed super rational organized, but then again there's also space which is sort of redundant maybe, where people actually come and meet each other and where they can engage where you can whatever reflect or find another way of use. So that's very specific, but also indeed looking at the warehouses, just there's so much they're so oversized, so that never happens anymore. No building is oversized. That's terrible. If you look ahead, what now we're transforming buildings from, I don't know, from 1900 or even earlier to. Sorry, I'm trying to read the chat at the same time. So there's a specific era of type of buildings that we can now transform into anything we like because they have this quality. While the buildings we are creating at this moment or the last 20 years are so tight, you cannot really do anything else but use them for what they were used for, and otherwise you have to demolish them and start again, which is it's stupid. It really is missed opportunities, I would say. Or you build something which can last for, I don't know, 200 years. That's also fine. What was the question?
No, there's a question from the audience, from Melissa. Maybe it's one last question and then we can close. But she asks, what do you think about the fact that drawings and buildings look so alike? Parentheses, colorful and joyful. I think she's talking about that. Maybe it relates to the flatness in different ways that buildings acquire.
Maybe how I understand the question, first of all, was, of course, you see a selection. We make, of course, there's a lot of different types of drawings, but if we want to visualize and communicate, let's say, our designs before they're built, then, we try to envision or to create an image which also really relates one-on-one with what is built in the end. And it's maybe something stupid, but I very often really compare the two, like, okay, and if the render the executed building is similar or hopefully, of course, better than the render, but similar in its appearance, or its atmosphere, let's say, then I'm very confident. Then I think, yeah, we did it. We we made it real. So if there is a big difference, I would be confused. So, but of course, we use so many different means of communication from super rational, technical BIM models, whatever, to indeed visualizations. It's not just one language, but we try to always, even with, you know, designing a detail of windowsill, you always have this concept in the back of your mind, like what was the message that we want to, what do we want to achieve with this building, and that should always, you should always be able to relate or explain how you actually materialized or detailed a certain building, referring back, as I said, to the first concept sketch, because then the puzzle seems to fit. I don't know if that's an answer to her question, but.
Well, I think we could go on, but it's also a good moment to stop. I want to thank you very much, Volker, for your time and generosity. It's been great having you with us, and I hope we can have you again soon.
Sure. And hopefully in real time, because
yes.
We had a nice chat with the three of us, but I hope other people enjoyed it too. So good luck. Thank you for the invitation. It was super nice. I think this is a very nice format indeed, not to have to lecture and to get questions. That's so much nicer. It's a nice change also for me. So
okay,
keep up the spirit. Yeah, thank you, and see you soon.
Okay, thank you very much.
All right, enjoy the rest of your day.
Bye bye.
Bye bye.
See you soon. Bye bye.